agree because I thought that since she's never done anything illegal before, she has nothing to hide.
But Mr. Hyde, Mr. Keenan lied to you twice, didn't he?
Kind of lost count. I really don't know. I think it was twice, yeah.
Well, the first lie was about his position, wasn't it?
Well, he told me he was an auditor, and then he told me he was an undercover cop.
So he did lie about his position. He told you he was an auditor, but in reality, he was an undercover cop.
Yeah, I'm guessing since he's an undercover cop, he didn't want people to know.
He also threatened you with jail time, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
He told you that unless you cooperated, none of your problems would go away.
Yeah, that's what he told me, and I thought, either way, it was the right thing to do to help out a cop, so I did it anyway.
Be clear, you've never done anything wrong, had you, Mr. Hyde?
Not that I know.
Meaning that any criminal activity that he would indict you with would be based on a lie, correct?
I don't know what he had on me.
But you just said that you never did anything illegal.
Again, that I know of. Maybe I did do something. I don't know what he had on me, so I just went ahead and cooperated.
Mr. Hyde, is your testimony today that you've never done anything illegal? Or that you have done something illegal?
That I have done something illegal?
Yes.
No. Like I said, no, I don't know if I have.
Mr. Hyde, you do know whether you've done something illegal, don't you? You've never done anything illegal.
No.
Thank you, Mr. Hyde. Now, after he told you this, he went over what he wanted from you.
Yeah, and he just wanted me to set up meetings. So I did. I mean, I'm executive assistant, so I'm in charge of that anyway.
You set up a meeting for the 31st, didn't you?
Yes.
But before this meeting, Mr. Keenan sent you an email, didn't he?
Yes.
Would you recognize the email report today?
Yes.
Let the record I'm approaching closing counsel refer to as defense day. Permission to approach with the same.
Thank you.
What did I say, Andy?
It's that email that Mickey Keenan sent me the day before.
And is this a fair and accurate copy?
Yes.
This time, defense moves to admit defense and evidence.
Any objection?
Yes, Your Honor. I get the hearsay.
Next one. Okay. Your Honor, this statement is being made by Mr. Keenan, and it's showing Mr. Hyde's subsequent actions following it, meaning that isn't accepted to hearsay. I'm going to show you that because of this email outlining how Mr. Hyde was supposed to act during this meeting, Mr. Hyde acted in compliance with Keenan's instructions, meaning that it's showing the way that he reacted afterwards.
So what exception is this?
It's, may I clear a couple?
You may.
How you should act and what you should say during this meeting.
Yes.
He told you to stay relaxed and act normal.
Yes, act normal.
And he also told you that you need to do something to sweeten the pot.
Objection,
relevance. We're trying to show that Mr. Keenan was attempting to entrap Mr. Bancroft in any statement that he would make trying to persuade Mr. Hyde to help convince Mr. Bancroft to commit the bribe is very relevant to the case. The bribe, in fact, is what we're here for.
I agree. Why is this not relevant to this case?
Covington Lease Avenue.
Mr. Covington?
I'm sorry.
You mean Mr. Bancroft?
To get this done, someone needs to be made happy, and that person is Chase Covington.
Oh.
That's what the email says?
Yes, that line, yes.
And during this meeting, Mr. Keenan does in fact say that everything needs to be done to make sure that everyone leaves happy from this meeting, right?
Yes.
Now, I'd like to bring you to the last meeting, March 6th, on April 16th.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
yes.
Mr. Covington did not show up this meeting, did he?
No, Mr. Covington didn't show up.
And this made Mr. Keenan furious, didn't it?
Objection, lady.
Never saw.
I agree, this is cross-examination.
Oh, sorry.
You may proceed.
Would you like to raise a question?
Yes, please.
Mr. Covington did not show up this meeting, did he?
No.
This made Mr. Keenan furious, didn't it?
Yeah, Mr. Keenan was a little bit mad.
And that Mr. Keenan told you, remember who we're dealing with. This isn't some game. If you don't find Bancroft, and I mean now, you're going to jail.
Yes, he said that.
No further questions.
You're allowed, correct? Okay, are you...
My name is Reese Warren.
And what is your role in today's case?
Well, originally, I was asked by defense to create an expert report on how the officer did things with the, I was originally asked by defense to create an expert report on how the officer, Mickey Keenan, went ahead and talk to the defendant, Avery Bancroft. Now, after I created this expert report, the defense told me that they did not need my assistance anymore. And so, a week later, the prosecution asked me to testify on their behalf.
And are you being compensated for your time in this case?
Yes, I am. The defense gave me a flat rate of $10,000 to create an expert report. And then I also received $500 from the prosecution for our testimony in today's case.
And do you have any specialized knowledge or experience that allows you to make your conclusions today?
Yes, I have a PhD in linguistics from Georgetown University, and it specializes in forensic linguistics and forensic psychology.
Do you have any specific professional experience relating to this case?
Yes, I am the chair of the Department of Linguistics at the Midland State University, and I also have a partnership with the Midland State Police Academy, where I lecture on how to talk to witnesses, well, how to talk to people in question in undercover operations. And I've also testified in 23 cases prior to this one on behalf of defense. And when they're alleging entrapment.
And what materials did you review in this case?
Well, I reviewed a transcript and a recording of a March 31st meeting, as well as an email correspondence on March 30th between Avery Bancroft, Officer Mickey Keenan, and the assistant Corey Hyde.
And were these materials sufficient for you to reach a conclusion today?
Yes, they were.
Now, I would like to talk about how you went about your analysis. What methods did you use?
Well, there are four different analysis techniques to prove two major components, clarity and power dynamics.
Now I'd like to go to talk about these components one by one. Now let's start with clarity. What do you mean by clarity?
Clarity is simply when you're trying to say, well, is it understood? Or the question is understood, does anyone in the party understand what's happening?
And what do you mean by power dynamics?
Well, power dynamics, it's interesting. See, between a, think about a job interview and a cocktail party. Well, at a job interview, the interviewer will have the major part of the power dynamic because they're the ones that are controlling what's happening in the interview. Now, at a cocktail party, everyone has the same understanding and the same amount of power dynamics when talking.
The methods that you use, are they standard in your field?
Yes, they are.
And did you apply these standards to your analysis reliably?
Absolutely.
I'd like to move on to your analysis. How did you begin?
I began with a transcript review. Here in the transcript review, I just simply review the transcript that was made from the recording. Now, in this case, the recording was from a wire that Assistant Corey Hyde, the informant, wore at a March 31st meeting. And while I was listening and reading the transcript to make sure that it was accurate, I noticed that the recording had a small section of static. Now, this little bit of static didn't affect the transcript and the recording as a whole. I was still able to come to a conclusion.
And what was that conclusion?
Well, that basically that everyone in the meeting had a clear understanding of what was happening.
So after you concluded your transcript review, how did you proceed in your analysis?
I proceeded to a topic content analysis. The topic content analysis is basically seeing what topics come up in the conversation. I was able to identify about 7 different topics, and they were all relating to business. Now, Officer Mickey Keenan began the conversation, and then Avery Bancroft continued the conversation.
Now, what was the outcome of this analysis?
Well, I was able to see that the power dynamics within the conversation were very appropriate for the officer, the undercover officer, and Avery Bancroft and the other parties. Officer Keenan began the conversation and then let Avery Bancroft continue the conversation. There was no time that Officer Keenan tried to tell Avery Bancroft what to do or what to say.
How did your analysis continue after this?
After the topic content analysis, I proceeded to my contrastive analysis. In the contrastive analysis, we look for clarity. And in that part, the officer has to start by using open-ended questions in the conversation. After the open-ended questions, the officer can proceed to give subtle hints to the parties, to whoever they want to give hints to. In this case, it was Avery Bancroft. Now, these subtle hints are just to see if, Avery Bancroft was going to latch onto these hints and incriminate himself.
And what did you conclude?
Well, Officer Keenan followed everything that he was supposed to. Officer Keenan began with the open-ended questions and then began with subtle hints. At no point did Officer Keenan blatantly tell Avery Bancroft to commit bribe.
Now, earlier you mentioned that you used 4 techniques. What was your last?
My last technique was a responsive analysis. In the responsive analysis, we just make sure that the language used is not ambiguous. And by that I mean that everyone in the conversation has a clear understanding of what is happening in this case, the meeting. They have to make sure that everyone in the conversation knows that what is the clarity of what is going on. Now, in this case, Officer Keenan, when he would suggest things, everyone knew what was happening. And Avery Bancroft, in this case, after reviewed the transcript, I could see that Avery Bancroft understood. At no point did Officer
Objection, speculation, Your Honor.
My witness has laid foundation that she has her a BA in psychology as well as being well studied in police techniques in undercover operations. She has testified in 23 of these cases. She has expert knowledge that allows her to determine based on transcripts whether or not the defendant, like in this case, would understand what the officer is saying based on Bancroft's responses that she was able to read.
May I respond, Your Honor?
You may.
This witness cannot attest to another person's mindset. That is speculation. Now, she said that Avery Bancroft understood what she was talking about, and that is simply speculation that is now allowed here.
May I
return,
Your Honor?
Briefly.
My witness is saying, based on Bancroft's responses that she has observed in this transcript, she is able to conclude, based on those, that Avery Bancroft clearly understood what Officer McKee was saying.
May I respond briefly, Your Honor?
No. I'm going to sustain the objection and start the testimony.
Thank you, Your Honor.
What are your final conclusions in this case?
Officer Keenan followed all the techniques that he was supposed to in this case. And at no point did Officer Keenan not use the techniques that were taught to him at the police academy. And he, like I said, he followed everything he was supposed to.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Cross-examination?
Yes,
Your
Honor.
William Rogers, Defense Command Court. Good morning, Doctor. Good afternoon, Doctor. Now, you are a linguist, correct?
Yes, I am.
And you're here today to determine whether or not McKee Keenan used the proper procedures.
Yes.
And part of being an undercover operative, you have to have basic training, correct?
Correct.
And part of that training is knowing things like best practices?
Correct.
And you're aware that there are four best practices? And part of their training as well is knowing how to avoid conversational strategies. And conversational strategies are proven scientifically to induce criminal activity in unwilling targets, correct?
Well, in this case, Officer Keenan followed the protocols. In this case, that was not.
But yes, looking back to my question, conversational strategies are scientifically proven to induce criminal conduct and unwilling targets, right?
I suppose, yes.
Now, Officer Keenan actually used 4 of the 10 conversational strategies.
Incorrect.
And one of those conversational strategies was coaching an informant, right?
Yes.
Now, may I retrieve evidence from the bench? Emails? Now, in the email exchange you reviewed as part of your evidence, you see that at one point, Officer Keenan asked Corey Hyde to sweeten the pot, correct?
These are suggestions.
Yes, but that is part of coaching an informant, correct?
Well, yes, the informant must know the subtle hints that have to go along with the conversation.
So if you were to take a test out of 10 questions and fail 4 of them, that would be around a 60% average, correct?
Your Honor, I ask that opposing counsel allow me to see my witness while she's testifying.
Okay. No, that's okay. If you need to move, feel free to move.
But yes,
Your Honor. So, I'll re-ask the question. So, if you were to take a test of 10 questions, fail 4 of them, that would be around a 60% average, correct? And that's close to failing.
Yeah.
Now, as an undercover operative, you think with his training, he should be able to understand that, right?
Well, yes.
I have no further questions at this time.
Any redress?
No, Your Honor. I was asking how he's be able to sit there. Excuse. say Chase, do you mean Chase Covington?
Yeah, he's my stepbrother. He's the only family I really have left, other than this little bundle of joy.
And do you know what your brother does for a living?
Yeah, he's been appointed commissioner on the Midlands Gambling Commission. He seems to be a pretty big deal around there.
Why do you say he's a pretty big deal?
Well, he's been known to get gifts for a favor or two.
Have you ever seen him receive favors?
Well, you think bureaucrats would be on 9 to 5, but Chase comes home really late at night and he's drunk and looks like he's just had a lot of fun. I'll ask him about it, but he just kind of blows me off and will give me hockey tickets or poker chips.
Objection, Your Honor, to relevance of this.
If I may proffer, this is laying foundation for testimony that Avery Bancroft came over to the home of Tracy Meadows and Chase Covington. This line of questioning is merely confidential.
I'm not allowed. This is the beginning of the direct.
Yes,
sir. Got it. The whole new proceeding.
Did you finish anything?
No, not yet. He gave me coffee tickets or poker chips to the Blackwood Casino. He even gave me gift cards to really nice restaurants over there. Come to think of it, he was there an awful lot. I mean, he even invited Avery Bancroft over to the house, and that was just really strange.
Miss Meadows, why was that strange?
We don't entertain much. I've never known Chase to bring anyone home.
And do you remember when Miss Bancroft came to your home?
Well, I remember it was after they announced the bid on October 1st, but it was before Thanksgiving because they had little paper turkeys all over town, and I remember thinking about how silly that was.
Do you remember what the conversation was about that night?
It just seemed to be mostly business jargon, but I do remember Bancroft saying something along the lines of, I know things like this require people like me to go above and beyond just a proposal, and I'm happy to go that extra mile.
Do you remember anything else about what they said that night?
Nothing real specific, but they were talking about how legendary it would be to get a new casino, and Bancroft said he had a plan to make it happen.
With that, I have no further questions.
Examination? Yes, Your Honor.
James from the defense, may I proceed? You said that you were a step-sibling of Chase Covington.
I do.
Chase Covington worked at the Gambling Commission?
For the Midlands, yes, he does.
The only interaction that you ever had with Ms. Bancroft was when she came to your home, isn't that right?
Yeah, it wasn't much of an interaction, though. She didn't really want to talk to me.
So, you can't tell us whether Ms. Bancroft ever gave Chase Covington favors, isn't that right?
That's true, I can't.
You aren't even aware of who Mickey Keenan is, correct?
No, I feel like I've heard the name, but I've never met that person.
So you cannot tell us whether Mickey Keenan may or may not have forced Ms. Bancroft to give Chase Covington anything?
No, I don't know really anything about it except what I've been told today.
Thank you.
Any regrets?
No, Your Honor.